And I'm going to introduce George, who's going to talk about SQL and all things in SQL. So I imagine we're going to be dreaming SQL after this talk.
No, not that much.
Might be still in there.
Oh, yes, of course,
it's in there, yes. And no, I had a USB stick.
The USB stick?
Yep. Thank you.
Full screen.
It's probably in view because no, it's probably in maybe in view.
No, view. Enter full screen. Yes. Okay.
Okay. May I start?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, what's this? Oh. Okay, hello everybody. My name is Jorge Sanz, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the work I've been doing in CARTO for the last year, more or less, over the data services API. Well, I'm a casual mapper since almost 10 years ago, but I haven't put my username, it's here, but not here on purpose, so you don't sneak on me, but I've been doing advocacy for since the beginning. But mostly my interest has been in the Open Source Geospatial Foundation. It's like an umbrella foundation for many open source for geospatial projects that you have heard about, like PostGIS, GDAL, QGIS, and so on. And yeah, my work is as a solutions engineer in CARTO. So I'm the guy that translates sales speaking to developers speaking, back and forth. So I'm like a translator of them, and I also manage the support team. So if you're interested in support in software as a software company, just reach out me. Yeah, because CARTO, well, it's not your CARTO. We were formerly CARTODB. We are a location as intelligence software as a service company. We have our product for 4 years or so, and yeah, we have offices in Madrid, New York, Tartu in Estonia, and now in London. So yeah, the product people are mostly in Spain, and the research people are in New York, and then sales are everywhere. Not that much in Tartu, but in Madrid we have a strong policy on free hacks. So if you go to Madrid and visit us, you will get a hack by the CTO or the other technical lead. Our mission as a company and product is to democratize location intelligence. So we try to give to everyone access to geospatial analysis capabilities, not just for data scientists or for GIS people, but also for journalists, for researchers in other fields. And yeah, we want everybody doing maps, basically. That's our mission. And that's important because we are not a location-based services company. We do some because we have some base maps, and that's part of what we know about location-based services. And we also are a little bit into GIS, or we were used to be more into GIS, but we are trying to move more in a different field that is called data analytics, and that geospatial location intelligence, that we are trying to make our own space there. And this is relevant for this talk because we are going to talk about location-based services and how we relate with that field. Our offering is trying to get people doing maps as beautiful as they can. Well, people always use the default orange. I hate it, but we try to make them making better things. We are now trying to push more on the analysis part, so we try to get, because people doesn't know a lot about SQL and PostGIS SQL, so we try to hide that for that kind of normal people. So we are exposing all the Postgres and PostGIS power through an interface, but it's not only that, and that's also relevant for this talk because location-based services are out of the PostGIS or PostGIS features. And of course, all of our products are open source. How we do, we were doing LBS previously. Our users were demanding geocoding, so we wanted to offer them geocoding on our product. That's our editor. And apart from that, of course, we were creating some base maps, so we were offering them as a default for our maps, but our users are allowed to use other base maps from other providers, or they can provide their own WMS services, etc. Regarding geocoding, we had our own very simple geocoding for the most basic stuff, like country names, place names, zip codes, IP addresses. But when we arrived to the street level, that's the most demanding one, we were using mostly, we had an agreement with Nokia here, and we were that's where our offering for our users. Of course, Nokia, well, now it's not Nokia, but we were paying to them. So we were that was part of our enterprise offering and a little bit about for our free users. And for other users coming from Google Map Engine, we were offering also Google. So we have two geocoding providers on the editor. And this is more or less the user interface. So those are the basic geocoding providers. That's always for free, and we provide them, we do all the infrastructure to do that. And when we arrive to the, that's the IP addresses, and we arrive to our streets, and if you use that, you consume credits, you end up going to Nokia here mostly, most of the times, and so on. But like a year ago, we were starting to push forward the platform, because many of our enterprise users were not using the editor, were using the platform, or APIs. And that, and they were also willing to have geocoding on their API, on our, as part of our APIs. And okay, how do we move the geocoding feature from the editor to the platform? We create a new API. So that's, we have the import API, we have the SQL API, and the maps API mainly. And it was like, okay, we can create a new one. But no, there wasn't. The best technical decision. So we create a new extension of our SQL API. So we have these functions inside the SQL API. So you don't have to we don't have to provide a new one. So we created a new data services part offering. That's mainly a Postgres extension that you can with functions that you can call on your own. On your own maps or on your own calls to the or SQL API. So technically, it's more, this is the most technical thing that I'm going to explain, apart from the SQL statements. So we have the, our users, they have their own database. So we have like 230,000 databases out there. And each one of those databases has the client part of the extension. Then when they call for an street geocoding, that's going to go to a central database that is going to use our Redis database, that's metadata of the users, to see which provider is going to use, if Google or here at the beginning, and provide, and then call to the API at the end, to the third-party API. So nowadays, it's Mapzen, and I'm going to talk about Mapzen in a second, but yeah, that the, this extension is a little bit dependent of the CARTO infrastructure, so, but you can get rid of it quite quickly. I mean, you can fake the CARTO APIs, and you can assume that your user has infinite quota, infinite access to these providers, and that's it. We are trying to refactor this a little bit to get completely independent of the or on other parts of the platform, but in general, it's quite easy to get it out of it. And of course, it's open. It, this infrastructure is open to provide more, yeah, more providers, other third-party providers, as we did with Mapzen. I don't know if you know this scene of the Night on the Opera, the Sanity Clause scene. Have you ever dealt with Google or here terms of service? For example, you have things like you cannot store a geocoding result for more than X Sundays. You cannot show the result of a geocoding on top of a different base map that the same provider, you cannot do a lot of things. And they get combination, and it's very, very hard to, at the end, perform an operation in a software as a service, as we are, that store data from users and that store the result of their analysis and so on. So we had to move to something different for most of our users. And that's where that's what it came to my mind when I thought about how CARTO and Mapzen started to relate. But it went more like this, like a couple of announcements of a partnership between us and Mapzen. Mapzen is a, you know them, they are, I don't know if there's someone from Mapzen here, but it's a company focused on providing services on top of OpenStreetMap data, like routing, geocoding, and base maps. So it was like, yeah, perfect. So that's what we did. We are getting away from here and Google, and we are moving to all those services to Mapzen. And yeah, the look of those queries for a final user is just like as easy as that. So you can run a query that just takes the data and creates as a result of the query a geometry, a PostGIS geometry that you can insert on your table or you can use in any of whatever you need. For routing, it's more or less the same, but you could provide a couple of two or more. There's another method for more than 2 points, and a method, and yeah, a way to transport, and you will get your geometry, the duration, the length of your trip. And the same for the isochrones or iso distances. So you provide a point, the way you want to move, and how much time or how much distance you want to transport yourself, and you will get back a polygon for every one of those times. This is how more or less it looks like in our builder now. So you can geocode just as a new process, as a new step on the analysis. You set the column name, you say how you want to do the geocoding, and you get your points back. I hope that you can see them. Now it's better. So from just a raw alphanumeric table, you get your own geometries on your table, and you can continue with your analysis. And for example, to continue with that analysis can be to calculate the area of interest. So your area of interest is candidate unit, so it's just a regular buffer, as a crow flies, as they say, or you can use time and a way to transport yourself. So instead of doing a regular buffer with PostGIS in the same interface without changing almost anything for the user, you get a isochrones feature. So this feature can be combined in all the other steps, so you can see that it's very, very transparent for your users. You don't need to know anything about SQL if you don't want to, but you can still use the SQL functions on your own developments or products that you can offer to your users. So, you can use this API, for example, on triggers. It is a very common scenario where you have some input from a third-party provider. You only get addresses, for example, and you want to convert on the fly as they are inserted in your database into a coordinate. Maybe you want also to validate that, or you want to calculate routes on the fly and to store just the duration. You are not interested in the geometry, but maybe you are interested in how much time you need to move to somewhere else. You can, of course, as I've seen, we've seen, use the builder without having any idea about all of this. Or, for example, a nice example is this one. You can combine the data services API with our name and maps API. That's an API to render data. And get at the end a simpler URL as this to do a chain of first geocode those postcodes or addresses and calculate the route. You can, for example, put that on a newsletter, for example, for a user, or the result of a cab ride in a Uber-like service, and then end up with an image on the fly without having to care about anything else on your process. And it's going to be cached, and it's going to be, of course, if it's cached, it's going to be super fast, and so on. Yeah, well, to finish, yeah, we are trying to give all the power and all the data that OpenStreetMap is producing to the and services on top of that that Mapzen are offering to our users and to everyone. That and we need to include LBS in our offering. We cannot create or pretend to have a complete product or a complete stack without those services. And yeah, Mapzen, the mix or the partnership, the open partnership, as they said, between Mapzen and CARTO is very, very, it's perfect for us. So yeah, that's all I got. Thank you. And if you have any questions, more than welcome.
All right, we have time for some questions about relations either in SQL or OSM or between companies. So yeah, we can maybe start.
Hi, thanks for that. That was great. Quick question, the builders, is that's open source, right?
Yeah.
The whole
system. Yeah, well, I haven't talked about the builder, but that's the user interface that is replacing our editor. And it's being rolled out over this month and a month and a half. And it's going to be available to everyone on the product, yes. Of course, in this case, this as it happened with the editor, all the quota and limits that we have with, for example, Nokia here, it's going to be applied also to the builder. But for, in the case of Mapzen, it's for free. Sorry, users, yes.
All right. Who else? There's a question there in the back.
Well, if someone wants a demo about the builder, just tell me. Yeah, who else?
Hey, Jorge. I'm going to ask a question that everybody hates, but that you have to ask whenever someone says geocoding and OpenStreetMap, which is, how do you guys think about the licensing implications of having the data that comes back from the geocoder and then storing it in your customer's database? Do you treat that as encumbered by the ODBL? Or, you know, I thought it was interesting that you mentioned the commercial licenses and then kind of said, the geocoding that comes back from OpenStreetMap is like totally open. So, how do you think about?
One of the mottos of the company is getting staying out of jail, because you know we've been doing this with Nokia, well here and Google, and still we are out of jail. But I would say that I don't have an answer for that on my own. We would should to talk with the guys on top.
All right. Who else has a question?
That's a good discussion on the booth at Mapzen booth.
There's one over here.
First, congratulations for using OSM. I just wanted to ask if I will do the geocoding in some cities that in OSM there is no data yet. How is this handled?
We cannot handle that. I mean, we are not. For example, from time to time we get, because I'm on support and we get the kind of request about, hey, we don't have data on this place, or the names of the streets have changed. So for example, the last time there was a big change of names in one town in Spain and we did all the changes. So eventually that it's shown on our base maps. But with enterprise users, we have a problem with that. When we have an enterprise user that needs accuracy on a place where OpenStreetMap doesn't have that coverage, we only can offer a different provider, of course.
Yeah. Right. Someone else? Raise your hand high if you have a question or else. All right.
No.
Okay. Then we're going to applaud once more. Thank you.